If you studied macroeconomics in a school or university in a Western democratic country, it is likely you would have been taught Keynesian economics, named after British economist John Maynard Keynes. In fact, this may be the only type of economic model you've ever come across if all you read is the corporate press. Now, before you think, oh no, you're going to try to show me a lot of boring graphs, or I've never studied economics, fear not. I will keep this video as high level and understandable as I can. The purpose of this video is to illustrate why the Keynesian model of economics, which societies now rely on to run their economies, is the root cause of a lot of problems being experienced around the world, such as high government debt, low wages, and reduced productivity, which decrease welfare for everyone. In this video, I'll explain what the Keynesian theory of economics is, what problems it has led to in economies, and why it should be rejected in favour of an alternative model. This video is brought to you by I Dream of Money. The channel brings you videos about business, economics, and money. Help us reach 1,000 subscribers by clicking on the like and subscribe buttons so you never miss out on a video to help you become a better investor. Macroeconomics is the study of the economy at large. Most governments around the world usually base their economic decisions on maximizing a number called gross domestic product, or GDP. GDP is meant to represent the total market value of the goods and services produced by a country's economy during a period. There are a number of ways of calculating GDP. However, one common way is the expenditure approach, which defines GDP as the sum of the following. This basically represents that there are three types of users of goods and services in an economy: households, businesses, and the government. As you can see from this calculation, private consumption and investment, government spending, and exports to other countries all increase GDP for an economy. What Keynes suggested was that in order to increase GDP, government expenditure should be increased and taxes should be lowered to stimulate private consumption and investment. This sounds pretty simple, right? However, what Keynes was arguing for was quite novel at the time. Prior to Keynes, economics was based on the classical model, which argued that the economy would always self-regulate to the natural level of GDP, which is the level of GDP that is obtained when the economy's resources are fully employed. This self-regulation occurs as interest rates, wages, and prices adjust so that the supply ends up matching the demand. Keynes's theory rejected the idea that the economy self-regulates through the natural changing of prices. His views came about during the Great Depression in the 1930s, which he believed proved that classical economics wasn't working. Instead, he believed that when there was an economic decline, the doom and gloom prevented the self-regulation of the economy, and that for this reason, governments should step in with extra spending by borrowing to reach the optimal GDP. So why is Keynes's theory a problem? Well, at the core of it is the idea that governments are better at regulating the economy than market forces between individuals and businesses. The adoption of Keynes's theory has empowered governments to spend their way out of financial crises, go into significant debt and print trillions of dollars in pursuit of this, and distort market forces, leading to inefficient allocation of resources. The reason few have complained about this until recently is due to the incredible growth we've seen over the last century. Many attribute this growth to Keynesian economics working. However, others argue that this growth occurred in spite of Keynesian economics. That is, due to increases in productivity as a result of enhanced technology and social liberation movements, growth would have been so much higher if the government hadn't gotten in the way of market forces. This is difficult to prove. After all, there is no universe B to test how society would have fared under a different economic model. If we look to history, however, the world saw incredible growth for centuries before governments got involved in economics. The industrialization of societies in the 1700s and 1800s improved the well-being of millions around the world. It should also be remembered that Franklin D. Roosevelt tried public spending to restart the US economy during the Great Depression, but actually never got the US out of recession until World War II. Many argue that it was the government spending on World War II that got countries out of the recession. However, there was also significant technological and social change which muddied the waters, not to mention the destruction of life and property. Now, with the world facing high inflation and governments owing trillions of dollars in debt, it's time to ask, is there a better way? In my view, Keynesian economics and the focus by governments on increasing GDP as an end goal for economies has failed societies miserably, creating financial system collapses time and time again in the less than 100 years in which it has been in place. The Austrian School of Economics, founded in 1871 by Karl Menger's Principles of Economics, argues that the only way to analyze economics is to look at a person and their subjective choices. Austrian economics reject the use of measures such as CPI and GDP to measure the health of an economy, finding them arbitrary and unsuitable for drawing any conclusions. I've previously talked on this channel about the failings of consumer price index or CPI to measure inflation. Austrian economists argue that societies should return to focusing on the decisions made by individuals and businesses rather than allowing governments to interfere with those decisions, as this will maximize welfare due to people being inherently self-interested in reaching the best outcomes. There is no optimal society-level measure. Rather, each person has optimal and changing preferences. If you'd like to find out more about Austrian economics, I've included a link below to a comprehensive article on the subject by EconLib, the Library of Economics and Liberty. I hope you found this video useful. Let me know in the comments below whether you agree that a new economic model is needed to fix the problems caused by Keynesian economics and what you think the solution should be. Thanks for watching, and until next time.